So I'm going to be short on slides today. I think we'll just put up this. What kind of soil are you? Because that's from Matthew 13. That's the question is, who are you? How is God working in your life? And it's part of you. And how do you receive this word? Over the last few weeks, before I left to marry off my eldest son, I've been laying the groundwork for where I want to go over the next few months. And therefore, I'm going to be repeating this, and you're going to be tired of it until you're not tired of it, and you're kind of going, oh, I get how important it is. If we want this congregation to continue growing, it implies that we know how to share our faith. We don't at our peril. Okay, we need to know how to share the faith, and so we've been spending time on that, how it's one thing for my faith to grow, but it's quite another for me to be able to share that faith. And so I remind you, and I'm going to ask you, because those of you have been around, how long does it take to disciple somebody into the church from the point of where they were to now getting them into the church? Statistically, survey says,
5 years.
There you go. Listen to you. Oh, that's awesome. That's just awesome. They've been listening to me. I just faith in me going, 5 years. I would think you need to come and turn your life over to God. In the name of Jesus, in the power of the Holy Spirit. Oh, sure, let's go do it. Doesn't happen that way. You need to walk with a person and disciple that person, share the faith, spend time with them so that when life happens to them, you are in a position to speak into their lives. So how do we speak into their lives? And that's the part of sharing the faith. And the way we speak into their lives is that we are so thinking the way God's thinking that we're able, and we have actually something to say. So that leads to my second point. First point is, takes 5 years. Second point is that to answer why many of us are having trouble relating the faith to others is that we do not know our Bibles. That is not to say that we can start quoting scripture at people. So why do we need to know our Bibles? So that I can quote Bible bullets at you. Right? You know, Bible bullets, you know. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. I mean, you just start quoting scripture at people. Generally speaking, that is very unhelpful, okay? So the reason I'm asking you to know your scripture is that all of a sudden it's so ingrained in you, it is such a part of the way you move and live and have your being, that all of a sudden it comes out in the way you speak and express things, and you know when to quote scripture and when not to quote scripture. And there's a certain wisdom that we are called to. And so I've been quoting Dallas Willard, who will put a picture of him up. And Dallas Willard is this philosopher, a very godly man, God rest his soul. I will continue to quote this line, that the reason we don't know our Bibles is that we do not read the Bible as a treatise on life. I'm going to keep repeating that until it is so ingrained in you that you believe it. And if you have a problem with it, then come and talk to me. The reason we don't know our Bibles is that we don't read the Bible as a treatise on life. This Holy Scripture is not just a book. It is that, written by men, not women, because that's the history, okay? And it's been passed down by communities and the community of faith. And it's the wisdom of those communities over centuries that all of a sudden we have what's called the canon of Scripture. But this canon is God-breathed. And so it is written by human beings on the one hand, but it is also breathed by God. That's Reformed theology, folks, just so you know. And that the Reformers, Luther and Calvin, would have articulated exactly what I've just said there, that therefore this is a dual authorship. And as you learn this book, it starts to shape your mind and your heart. And the reason this book is dry and dusty to many of us is that we do not recognize that it is actually a treatise on life. This book is, in fact, your manual for living. It's way more practical than people think. Like, what's this got to do with where I live today? Well, that's the job of the preacher, and it's your job as you read it. That's why we have study groups, and that's why we work so hard at these things. So, thus my goal is that you will buy Bibles. You will bring your Bible to church. And note that when it said 1 Corinthians, it just gave you a page number. It didn't read it out. Because I want you to get in the habit of opening the book and reading it So that when I say Romans 5, you know where that is. When you say Corinthians, you know where that is. And if I say Ezekiel, you know where that is. That only comes by you being familiar with the text. And that comes just by time. I'd like to begin my sermons with something generally on the lighter side. It's in the context of what kind of soil are you, and that there is the parable of the weeds, and it raised up the question of judgment. But I want you to know I'm not like the evangelist who said, there will be weeping and wailing and gnashing of teeth among the wicked who pass on to the next world. One old-timer responded, what about old guys like me who don't have any teeth? Without missing a beat, the evangelist says, don't you worry, teeth will be provided. The one I like really is when it's about, because we're always looking for an out clause. I don't know how many lawyers are here in the midst, but these two guys are dressed in business suits and they're standing at the pearly gates. One is carrying a briefcase, a very large leather briefcase. And there's St. Peter, and he's standing in the billow of clouds all around him. And he's standing at that desk with his pen open and the book of life and the book of judgment. And he's sitting there. And he looks at these two guys, and I don't think he knows them. And he says, tell me, who are you? What's your name? And one fellow says, well, my name is Howard C. Freswell, but this is Arthur Templeton. He's my attorney. See? So we're always looking for an out clause. I don't know. What I'm saying is you're not going to find an attorney at the pearly gates who's going to get you out. Jesus is the one who gets you in and out, and that's the point. Sometimes we're just unaware, and we need to work through some stuff. We need to grow in our understanding of this complex subject, and I will attempt to make some biblical inroads for you. Scripture is clear about one thing, and that is for sure. That we will all stand before the throne of God at the end of day and have to give an account of our lives. We will be judged, says the scriptures. The church will be judged first, so it's not as though we get off. The church gets judged, and then the world. That's the way it works. And I need biblical reference for that, so I want you to turn in your Bibles to Romans chapter 14. I'm going to read to you a couple of verses. I'm going to be using my NIV Bible. It's a little different than some of you've got, but I turn to Romans, and I just want to hold on to chapter 14. I'm going to read you a couple of verses, verses 10 to 12. You then... I'm in verse 10 of chapter 14 of Romans. You then, why do you judge your brother? Why do you look down on your brother, sister? For we will all stand before God's judgment seat. It is written, as surely as I live, says the Lord, every knee will bow before me, every tongue will confess to God. Now, that line of scripture, by the way, is where many a person comes up to a position of universalism. Okay, lines like that are curveballs. I'm not going to go there today, but the text says, every knee shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Everybody will go, oh my God, that's God. And they will bow their heads before God. Arguably, there's a strain of scripture there. But the point is you will stand before God. So then each of us will give an account of himself to God. That's verse 12. So we need to recognize that judgment is actually part of God's economy. And as much as we don't like that, and we certainly don't talk about it in the church, because we always want to talk about how forgiving God is, and that's fair enough, and that God is ultimately merciful. But the issue is, mercy doesn't make any sense unless there's judgment. Right? Mercy from what? There has to be some kind of guideline. You can look up in 2 Corinthians 5, which repeats 5:10, which repeats the point. My point about this is, and here's a practical application, your life matters. Here's a practical point for evangelism. I think judgment is actually a gift from God. Now, I have the blessing of five children, four boys, one girl, all in their 20s, one on the edge of 30. Okay? One's married. I bump into a lot of people in their 20s and 30s, a lot. And I'm actually in the beginning process of discipling somebody who is a friend of one of my sons, who is actually wealthy, good looking, he's got a job, doing well, 28, and he's depressed. And I'm not talking clinical depression. I'm not going there. But I'm saying that he is saddened by life. There is no purpose in his life. He's not a believer. And I realize that when I spoke to one of these guys, this fellow in particular, this whole notion of judgment actually gave dignity to him. Rather than fearing judgment, it was like, huh, that means that if there is a God, there is purpose and meaning. That's the crisis of our 20 and 30-somethings of this generation. I mean, quite frankly, they're drinking and they're smoking and they're whoring and they're doing what they do. And if you don't like that, I'm sorry, but that's the truth. That's what's going on. And part of the reason that's going on is that there's a lack of meaning. And I'm saying that this Christianity gives me purpose and meaning. It tells me which way's north, which way's south. It gives me some orbit and some direction. That judgment that God shares to me, is a conviction that he gives to me, is actually a blessing. He says, don't go there, go here. Don't go there, go here. So be careful about worrying about words when you're talking to people, because sometimes the word that you think that they're afraid of might be in fact the word that they actually need to hear. As I said in 1 John 4:17, it comes true that we'll have confidence on the day of judgment. You don't need to look this one up, but you can write it down because you're taking a note. 1 John 4:17, that we will have confidence before the throne of God. So I don't walk around living in fear of judgment. I know I'm not perfect and God's still working on me. God knows God's still working on me. But the issue is that there's a peace that comes, notwithstanding that there's a judgment. Because God's in the business of trying to restore us to a fuller place. So, the Oxford Dictionary defines the word judge. It's a huge entry when I looked it up. To judge is to determine truth. But it is also to act the act of passing sentence, says the Oxford Dictionary. When we judge something or someone, we pass sentence. There's something final about it. There's a finality. And that is what is so desperately wrong with it. When you judge something, you are pronouncing guilt or innocence. And to decide it in an ultimate fashion, and to quote the dictionary, also is to condemn. So we all say, thankfully, only God can see the whole story. Only God has all the data and can make that final arbitration. So that understanding should inform you as you turn to Matthew 13. So please turn to Matthew 13. We've been looking at it. It's in the lectionary. We've been studying it over the last number of weeks. I think it's about page 1020 in your pew Bible. Matthew 13, 1 to 9 is the parable of the sower. The seed fell on hard ground. The seed fell on good ground, etc. And I preached about that last week. Okay. This week, we're going to touch on what was read last week, because there's so much material. I can't get through it all. And in Matthew 13, we have also the parable of the weeds. That's verse 24 and following. I'm going to speed read it for you. Very brief, okay? Because you're all quick. You can get this. Jesus tells him another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like a man who sowed good seed in his field. But while everyone was sleeping, his enemy came and sowed weeds among the wheat and went away. When the wheat sprouted and formed heads, then the weeds also appeared. The owner's servants came to him and said, "Sir, didn't you sow good seed in your field? Where did the weeds come from? An enemy did this." The servants asked, "Do you want us to go and judge it? Pull them out and weed the garden." Verse 29, "No, because while you're pulling the weeds, you may uproot the wheat with them." Okay. What's the lesson? Do not judge. Okay. Don't go around weeding. The parable is, okay? You got to go around. Don't smoke the weed, okay? You just don't go there, all right? Okay. The garden is the world. It's God's world. And he plants the seed. And up comes good seed. But there are some rotten seed. You know, we've all bumped into the dark side. Who did this? It was Satan. Later on, he explains it and he unpacks the lesson. I'm just explaining that to you. But what happens is that the zealous ones, you and me, who are on side with God and want to please God and want to walk with God, we say, oh God, that person's really bad. Do you want me to just, you know, discipline this person? And God says, or weed, right? And God says, don't. Because Drew, you can't see as clearly as I can. And that person, in fact, might be wheat. Maybe a little off course, but the person's wheat. You don't know, you haven't walked in their shoes. You don't know their circumstances. Thou shalt not judge. Okay? Full sermon, sit down, preacher. I got it. I've taught you nothing new. Would you agree? All of you know, thou shalt not judge. We live by that edge. We don't always fulfill it, but we all know that that's truth. Turn to a curveball's coming, folks. I don't preach without a curveball. There's a slider. It's a spitter. I don't know what it is, but it's not coming across the plate straight, and it's going to be a curveball at you. Now, I want you to turn to Jesus' seminal teaching, the Sermon on the Mount, and that's in Matthew. What chapters? Come on.
5 to 7.
Oh, very good. Okay. Matthew chapter 5 is that blessed are the poor in spirit. There's the kingdom. That's the blesseds. You know, you get that one? That's the Sermon on the Mount. Sermon on the Mount is actually 3 chapters. It's way more than just those blessedes. Okay, so those beatitudes. I want you to turn to chapter 7 of Matthew's gospel. Now, if you're going to struggle with this sermon and where I'm going, I want you to know that I'm leaving on vacation right after church. I'm going, Katie. You got room in your suitcase. I'm off. I'm out of town. Okay. You may not like where I'm going to go here, and I hope to be understood. I'm hoping to create really important lunchtime conversations. I want you to wrestle with this, and the purpose of opening your Bible is that you will actually gain more understanding than me just yakking at you. It's really true. Matthew 7, verse 1, Jesus says, and it couldn't be clearer, do not judge, or you too will be judged. For in the same way you judge others, you will be judged, and with the measure you use, it will be measured to you. Okay, so take the plank out of your own eye before you start judging somebody else. And that's where we get that. It's Sermon on the Mount. Everybody nod. Everybody knows this. Everybody's good with this, right? Okay. Verse 6. Take a look. Sounds blessedly judgmental to me. What does he say in verse 6? Do not cast your pearls before swine. You have this pearl of great value, this gospel message. And there are people who are going to trample all over it. Don't you pass that gospel on. He just called a bunch of people swine in the text. Deal with it. Sorry, folks, it sounds pretty judgmental to me. That implies that you know who's swine and who isn't. And that takes a certain amount of judgment on your behalf of discerning what... Oh, did I use the word discerning? There's the edge of the sword. There's a distinction to be made between judging somebody and discerning. And that's your lunchtime conversation. What is that distinction? To discern, I got notes here. It implies that you are able to discern with the mind and make an evaluation. That's what Oxford is basically saying. That's a paraphrase. Can't find it in my notes. So the point is that we're called to be discerning. Jesus is tired of Christians who are nerds. Jesus is tired of Christians who are not wise as serpents, who can discern and are mature and can figure out how to walk in this world. Matthew 7, verse 15, watch out for the clergy. That's Drew's translation. Watch out for false prophets. They come to you in sheep's clothing. They wear black shirts and white collars and you trust them. But deep inside, they're ferocious wolves. Now, I'm not a ferocious wolf. Trust me. Okay? How do you know I'm not a wolf? How do you know I'm not a raven wolf?
And
you're discerning. Bingo. You're discerning, but also you know your Bible well enough. So if I start doing stuff, you're able to go, you know, Pastor, I think you're out of line here. That's a sign of a healthy community. I would take that rebuke if I was doing stuff, because I don't want to do damage. I really want to be sheep. I want to be shepherd or sheep and that sort of thing. But the point is that Jesus is saying, use your discernment. And we often don't. So here's one, okay? The text of Corinthians is the last one I'm going to use today. 1 Corinthians 5. You can turn to it while I'm talking to you. I don't like talking about sex because it just gets everybody all worked up. But the text is about incest going on in the church. So let's just change the topic, okay? Because it's just too uncomfortable, okay? Did you hear that the minister down the block, not here, the minister down the block, was embezzling money from the church? And that happened. Peter just said, and that happens a lot. Okay? Governance. Sounds boring. Really? Governance? How does your church govern itself? We have rules around here. And for that very reason, I don't touch money. I raise it, but you guys count it. I don't, you know, it's not for me to touch it. I bless it, and then the wardens walk off with it somewhere, okay? I don't know. They go off and they count, okay? All right? But darn it, bust it again, okay? But the point is that this sermon's going way longer than it needs to. Okay, here's the piece, is that you are called to be discerning about how this goes on. But what happens is I hear in our culture, and sometimes I'm worried that you, us Christians, have bought a worldview that lacks the nuance between discernment and judgment. So the minister has just embezzled money from the church, and you say, who am I to judge? Now, would you say that? No, you say, fire his little tail, right? That sounds awfully judgmental, Mary. Wise though, and she's not judging. That's the point. It is discipline of the church, and that's what's going on in Corinthians. So please turn to 1 Corinthians 5. I'm going to read it to you and then we can wrap up. But this is the piece of why Scripture is so relevant and Scripture is so helpful on how do we live and do our job. Now I got to find it. 1 Corinthians 5. It's the whole chapter. I'm going to jump around in it. It is actually reported that there is sexual immorality among you, and of the kind that does not occur even among the non-believers. A man's in an incestuous relationship, and you're proud. You should rather have been filled with grief and have put him out of the fellowship, the man who did this. This is the doctrine of excommunication. Okay? Now, there's a whole bunch of stuff that needs to be talked about. We'll take a good hour, and we're not going to go there today to qualify this. But it implies that there is discipline in the church. I am a man under authority. My bishop is my boss. And if he says, do this, I'm under his authority. And there's a discipline that goes on. And we need to be people who are disciplined. So I say, I was in a church and the guy's committing adultery and he's taking communion and I'm going, you can't do that. And he says, who are you to judge me? He says, I'm the church. That's who. We are called to discipline one another in love. Ephesians 6, discipline one another in gentleness and kindness. And because you might fall from grace yourself. But if there is a problem, but the community needs to be whole and healthy. And we need to provide that judgment one with another in our baptism. So here's the point that's practical that I think is so profoundly helpful. Paul says, and if this is the word of God, which I believe it is, verse 9 and on really helps. I have written you in my letter not to associate with sexually immoral or embezzlers or robbers or whatever. But he says in verse 10, not at all meaning the people of this world. So he's making a clear distinction between those of us in the church and those who are on the outside of the church. We cannot impose our values on a non-believing culture. We can try to influence them. I'll go to Parliament and I will try to convince them to come to our way. But it must come by moral suasion only. Paul says in this text, I don't judge them. God judges them. Those are on the outside of the church. Swindlers, verse 11. But now I'm writing you that you must not associate with anyone who calls himself a brother or a sister, who is living an errant life, or a greeter, an idolater, or a slanderer, or a drunkard, or swindler. With such a person, don't even eat. And here's the punchline. What business is it of mine to judge those outside the church? I think that says an awful lot about how we as a church oppose abortion policy in Parliament, for example. We assume that everybody, you're going to hell. Maybe they're not going to hell. They're doing what's right by their standard. And this is difficult for us to live in. Folks, I am asking us to not judge. To live in the world is a difficult thing. But if this person is living an errant lifestyle, but doesn't claim Christ, then the real issue is Jesus, not their lifestyle. The issue is to bring them to Christ. And once they come to Christ, then God starts to do this convicting to say, oh, I did this, now I should do that. So I leave you with this. I'm saying, do not judge. That's big point. But I'm also asking you to be discerning. Don't condemn. But we need to make a clear distinction between those who are on the inside of the church and those who are on the outside. And this is not trendy in biblical circles and church circles. We say, oh, the whole world is God's. It is all God's. But you are, in your baptism, set apart. And we need to treat each other arguably a little differently as we become whole and purified and sanctified so that we stand before God. So I leave you with this. Be yeast. Be that yeast that spreads through the whole loaf. There's good yeast in Scripture and there's bad. And that's the unleavened bread and how it grows. So an evil can grow in the church if you just let it grow. But goodness can happen. So much so that it will compound. 100 times, 60 times, 30 times. Your good actions will have consequences from generation to generation. I leave you the question, what kind of yeast are you? What kind of soil are you? For those of you who have ears, let them hear.